Have fun, Brian. All right. Oh, we're live? Okay. Well, here. You can splice this, right? Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you for being with us today. A special welcome to those who are watching online. We're thankful you're with us. Today is the fourth Sunday in the season of Lent. In our service today, we're going to focus on the comfort and courage we have because of our awesome God. We have a special service that we'll be following today. It's projected for you in the front. We start with an opening prayer. Let's pause for a moment of private reflection, and then we'll begin with that prayer. We pray. O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are the one true God. Dear Lord and God, you have promised that wherever two or three gather in your name, you are with them. We ask you, Lord, to bless us today as we worship you. We ask you, Lord, to bless all who are with us today or might be watching this service.
Please also bless the pastor as he leads us in worship and shares your word with us.
We pray this trusting you will answer this and all our prayers in the way that is truly best for us. And we'll continue with the hymn Day by Day.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We'll continue with the responsive reading of verses from the Psalms. My soul rests quietly in God alone.
My salvation is from Him.
He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress.
I will not be disturbed.
Look, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear Him, on those who wait for His mercy. Know that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are His.
We are His people, the sheep of His pasture.
Those who know your name will trust in you.
For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you.
We'll continue with the hymn verse. As we worship the Lord and seek His help during this difficult time in our world, let us go to Him and confess our sins. O Triune God, You are the one true God, the God of all people must answer to. You demand that all people be completely perfect without any sin whatsoever. Yet we confess that we are by nature sinful. We were sinful when we started our lives at conception. There have been times when we knowingly and deliberately disobeyed your commands. There have been times when we have sinned and did not even realize it. We admit, Lord, that we deserve death and your curse now and forever in hell because we have sinned and because we are sinful. But you have told us that you are not willing that any should perish. In love, dear Father, you sent your Son, Jesus, to pay for and wash away all our sins and all our sinfulness. We humbly ask and trust that you forgive us because of Jesus' perfect life and innocent death. Be of good cheer, you who sorrow over sin. The Lord is compassionate and merciful. Because of the perfect life and innocent death of His Son Jesus, He has truly forgiven all your sins. Do you believe this? Rejoice! The Lord Jesus has risen from death to give us absolute proof that He has paid for and wiped away all our sins. Do you believe this? The Lord Jesus has defeated death and has won eternal life for all people. He gives us His forgiveness and eternal life as a free gift. Do you believe this?
Yes.
Join with me, people of God, in repeating these blessed words of the Bible. The undeserved gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The one who believes in the Son has eternal life. Do you believe these words of the Bible?
Yes, I believe.
May the Lord be praised for leading you to know and believe these precious truths.
Praise be to you, O Lord, glory be to your name.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, the world around us is sinful, and the effects of sin often touch our lives. Please give us your strength, your help, and your guidance as we face hardships in this world and strive to remain faithful to you. We pray this to you, trusting that you will hear and answer our prayers because of Jesus, your Son, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Old Testament lesson today is written in the third chapter of the book of Habakkuk. We start with verse 17. Regardless of how difficult things are in life, we can have confidence and joy because of our Lord and His salvation. The fig tree may have no buds. The vines may have no grapes. The olive tree may fail to produce. The fields may yield no food. The sheep may be cut off from their flock, and there may be no cattle in the barns. But I will delight in the Lord and rejoice in the God who saves me. The Lord God is my strength. He will give me feet like a deer and make me leap along the high hills. So far, our Old Testament lesson will continue by reading responsively Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength. That is why we will not fear when the earth dissolves. Its waters roar and foam. There is a river, its streams bring joy to the city of God. God is in her, she will not fall. Nations are in turmoil, kingdoms fall. The Lord of armies is with us. Come, look at the works of the Lord. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations.
I will be exalted on the earth.
The Lord of armies is with us.
The God of Jacob is a fortress for us.
And we'll continue with the hymn verse. For our epistle lesson today, we'll read selected verses from the fourth chapter of Paul's letter to the Philippians. I have learned to be content in any circumstances in which I find myself. I know what it is to live in humble circumstances, and I know what it is to have more than enough. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, while being full or hungry, while having plenty or not enough. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And my God will fully supply your every need according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. We continue with the hymn verses.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson today is written in the sixth chapter of St. Matthew. We start with verse 25, the Lord assuring us that our God does watch over us, and as we put him first, he will take care of every earthly need. Jesus is speaking and says, "For this reason I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much worth much more than they? Which of you can add a single moment to his lifespan by worrying? Why do you worry about clothing? Consider how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin, but I tell you that not even Solomon in all his glory was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, will he not clothe you even more, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What will we eat?' or 'What will we drink?' or 'What will we wear?' For the unbelievers chase after all of these things. Certainly your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." So far the gospel. We'll continue with the hymn. God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." Amen. The words of God we'll consider today on the fourth Sunday in the season of Lent are written in the 89th Psalm. We read verse 8. "O Lord God of armies, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you." This is God's word. In the name of our gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, dear friends in Christ, have you noticed in the new translation that we've been using, the wording that we have, did you notice it in Psalm 46? The Lord of armies is with us. And here, O Lord God of armies, who is like you? Well, in the Hebrew, the word that's used there does have the idea of an army, of a force that's organized and ready for battle. The Lord of armies. And we think of the forces that are at his disposal, that he uses for his purpose. The book of Revelation speaks of thousands upon thousands of angels that are at his beck and call, that God uses as he wishes for his purpose. but God has other forces that he can use. We think of the heavens, the stars, the sun, the moon. They are all there because he put them there, and he uses them for his purpose. You think of Joshua fighting the enemies of Israel, praying, and God made everything stop. The sun stayed in its place, and the Israelites had light so that they could continue to fight and defeat their enemies. You think of the forces of nature that are also at his command and how God uses them for his purpose. Oh, you think again of the Israelites at the Red Sea and the wind that opened up the sea and dried the ground so that they could pass through. All these forces at his beck and call, used for his purpose. And then we think of all the animals that exist and that they all answer to him. The birds fly south, they come back in the spring, again because of his power and because of his command. O Lord of armies, who is like you? No one. Our God is awesome. Note what else he says. You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. Faithfulness, that God is always true to himself and always does what he says. And because he's almighty, he can do whatever he says. He's almighty, and so whatever he promises always comes to pass. And again, you can look back at history and see God's mighty power going hand in hand with his faithfulness to himself, to his word, and his promises. You can think of the promise he made back in the Garden of Eden that someone would come to win salvation, and how he controlled the events of history to bring this about. In choosing the Israelites and protecting them. And we spoke a little bit earlier of his power in leading them away from the Egyptians. How awesome it was what he did and providing for them for 40 years in the wilderness. How awesome that was. And then bringing them to the promised land and allowing them to conquer their enemies and settle there. And then preserving the family line of David. If you read through Psalm 89, the writer has concerns. What's going to happen? The Babylonians attack and capture the Israelites, and they're led away into captivity, and it seems there's no king anymore. God had promised that the dynasty of David would endure, but it seems there's no king. But yet God controls all things, and he protects David's line so that when the time is right, a baby is born in Bethlehem, a descendant of David, who then now rules on David's throne, a throne that he earned for himself by, again, keeping all of God's promises, fulfilling all the prophecies. We think of how awesome it is that we have what we have because of what Jesus has done. Think, I'm forgiven for everything, regardless of what the mistake might be, and I don't have to do anything for this. This is awesome. I'm God's child. I'm an heir of eternal life. I'm going to live forever in perfect glory, and I don't have to do anything for this. This is awesome that God has done this for me. I'm God's child, and I have that confidence that he's going to continue to watch over me and take care of me. And I think of him again. O Lord God of armies, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. And think of how God controlled all things throughout history, even the forces of nature, to make sure that everything was fulfilled so that salvation has been won. Think of everything he has done in our lives to make sure that we have come to know him and have saving faith in him. You can think of events throughout history, God in control, God leading his people. And all those things in the past assure us our God is mighty, our God is faithful, and we can be sure of that even now. How comforting it is to know how awesome the Lord is. When you think of the coronavirus, are you filled with any unrest? Do you worry? What else bothers you? The fact you might get it? The fact that someone you care about might get it? The fact that some people have died from it? Certainly those are things that weigh on our hearts. But how about this? Do you feel uncomfortable because there's so much that's out of our control? There's certain things we just can't do, that we don't know exactly for sure how all of this is going to play out. How bad is it going to get? We take precautions. We are as careful as we can, but there comes a time when we've got to go out in public. We've got to go to the store and get groceries. And who knows that you grab a door, and maybe minutes earlier, somebody with the virus has just put their hand on it, and inadvertently you touch your face. Or you go and you take something off the shelf. Who knows that maybe somebody else had taken that, looked at it, put it back, and they had the virus. Or you take produce, who knows who's touched it and what there might be. And it makes you feel uncomfortable. There's things that we cannot control. There's things we're not sure of. The unknown is there. And that's when we have to remember, O Lord God of armies, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. Sometimes it seems that perhaps the Lord puts us in positions where we are helpless, where we can't control things, so that we have no choice but to look to Him and to trust in Him. And when we're not looking anywhere else, when we can't count on our own abilities to take care of things, when we have no choice but to trust in Him and do nothing else but trust in Him, that's really when we're strongest, at our best. What did the Lord say to the Apostle Paul? Or what did the Apostle Paul say? The Lord had sent him that thorn in the flesh to keep him weak. And Paul says, when I am weak, I am strong. So, with things out of our control, facing an unknown future, we are going to focus on our Lord. And how comforting it is to know how awesome our God is. We think of the heavenly armies at His command, and how He controls all things for the good of His people. And we'll put our confidence in Him, His power, His might, His faithfulness, that He makes His promises. Because He's almighty, He can always keep those promises. He calls on us to pray, and He calls on us to trust. And that's what we'll do. We will say our prayers. Lord, please stop the spread of this virus. Bring this to an end soon. Please, Lord, help us to be careful. Help us so that we're not foolish and put ourselves in harm's way. Please, Lord, keep the virus away from us. Please keep it away from the people that we love. Help us to trust. You always have a plan. If by chance one of us gets it, please, Lord, let it be something that doesn't cause a lot of trouble. Help us to get over it quickly. Please, Lord, help us to trust that no matter what, You love us and You are with us. And even if You allow this to go on for a time, even if You would allow one of us to contract it, help us to remember You are God, Your ways are always right. Help us to trust You will see us through. You will give us strength to endure. Help us to trust You will work all things out for our good. And help us to think how You are in command of all the heavenly forces. Remember when the devil came to talk to God about Job, and his basic thought was, the only reason Job is faithful to You is because You're good to him. Send him troubles and he'll curse You. And God said, very well. But then, remember, He put limits on the devil. God is always in control, And that's what we keep in mind even as we go through this. He's the Lord of armies. He's control of all the forces of heaven, all the forces of nature, and all the forces that are on earth. And he uses them in his wisdom to accomplish his good purpose. And his purpose is always, ultimately, to bring glory to his name, to bring blessings to his people. In some cases, he does bring punishment on those who have rejected him. In some cases, he's working to lead people to wake up, to repent, to think about him, and to turn back to him. Because he doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants all people to be saved. He wants us to have that perfect glory that will never end, and to lead people to look to him and think about him, or to make sure that we don't stray away, to lead us to go back to him and cling all the more to his promises, to pray all the more fervently, to make sure we stay focused on him so we don't lose our faith. Sometimes he will allow hardships and troubles like the things we're going through now, but it's all because he loves us and wants what's best for us. And we can remember he's in control and is always working for us. We think again, O Lord God of armies, who is like you? And there's no one like him. There's no one like the Lord. You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. You cannot separate God from his faithfulness. He's mighty. He's faithful, and he'll use his might and work through his love to care for each one of us. God will see us through this. He will help us. He will strengthen us. He will see us through, and he will make sure that we are preserved and that we are blessed. And we can be sure of that because he is truly an awesome God. And how comforting it is to know how awesome the Lord is. Amen. We'll continue with the singing of the next hymn. And we continue with the response of prayer. O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we call to you today because you are the one true God who is almighty, all-knowing, and all-wise. Lord, because we trust your power, and because you have assured us that the prayers of the righteous are powerful and effective, we call upon you to use your almighty power to stop the spread of the coronavirus.
Please, Lord, we ask you to heal those who have contracted this or any other virus for us. We ask you to protect all people in this world.
Lord, we ask that you guide us and our leaders during this time of unrest and uncertainty. Dear Father in heaven, we ask you to send the Holy Spirit to our hearts to strengthen our faith. Finally, we ask that you would work through this in all the events of our world to lead people to turn to you and to your word.
We especially ask that you use these and other world events to lead those people who do not know you or have rejected you to think about you and to go to your word to learn the truth about you.
Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Gracious Father, we pray with confidence, trusting that you will hear and answer our prayers because of your Son Jesus, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And we'll continue with the hymn. We pray. O Triune God, it is through your word that you make us wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. It is in your word that you give us promises to sustain us, to comfort us, and to strengthen us.
Please send your Holy Spirit to work in our hearts so that we will cling all of your time.
Please be with us in our lives and guide us in the way you would have us go. We do this trusting you will hear us because of God the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. I will say to the Lord, in complete peace I will lie down and I will sleep. How blessed are the people for whom this is so. Be strong and let your heart be firm. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
And we'll close with the final hymn.